Well, we as the Digrati family today have brought to you the first ever Tech Innovation Summit in Africa, which was organized by the Faculty of Computing and Informatics at Barra University of Science and Technology. We had our chief guest as the Honorable Dr. Elioda Tumwesigye, the Minister of Science, Technology and Innovation. Guess how the minister was surprised to hear how the students of Barra University of Science and Technology described him. They gave 6 ways on how they knew the minister. Let's watch.
Honorable Minister, while we were waiting for you, we moved around randomly a number of students and said we wanted to introduce the minister. I have about 6 introductions and they all belong to you. So I will quickly read them out on how people understand you. The Honorable Elioda Tumwesigye, in 2018, he made history by becoming the first MP in post-independent Uganda to hold 2 seats in parliament. And he had to be begged to leave, to let one go, which he gracefully did. He is now the first MP of Shema Municipality in the new Shema district. The Honorable Elioda is the first Minister of Science and Science, Technology and Innovation in the whole of Uganda. The Honorable Elioda is also the first Ugandan Minister of State for Health to be within the same ministry to be elevated to full minister. And when he became full minister, he was really replacing a newly appointed prime minister of a republic. It was further told to me that the Honorable Elioda is the first MP in Ugandan history to promote and lead a new committee in parliament on an epidemic disease. The first HIV/AIDS committee of the parliament of Uganda was really led by him, reappointed twice. And what it had to do for the first time, it was the first HIV/AIDS modern rural policy that provided that we scale up HIV/AIDS globally, internationally, making Uganda a model that had leaders interfacing to deal with an epidemic, political leadership. We also know that Honorable Elioda is credited for developing a modern rural health care center, serving over 5,000 people, bringing HIV/AIDS treatment to the communities. He is like an ICT enabling people get quality health through what is popularly known and powerfully known as Kabohe Clinical Resource Center. The Honorable Elioda, as a medical doctor, is also an author. He is recorded to have authored the first teacher's handbook on HIV/AIDS prevention in schools. The Honorable Elioda is said to be a permanent friend of Mbarara University. And every time he is on campus, we know that mangoes phone. Honorable Elioda, in our audience, as you come to speak, we have a number of visitors from agencies. NITA Uganda, represented by Joshua Akandwanaho, your Assistant Commissioner Patrick Mugisha, in charge of intellectual property management. He's been here with us, and we are proud of the knowledge he shared this morning in the panel discussion. Commissioner Mugisha. We also have Comtech Uganda, which you know very well, Honorable Minister, represented here by Nuriat Nambogo. Then we also have young minds, brilliant people, teachers and lecturers. The media is all here. Honorable Minister, I now beg that the Vice Chancellor formally request you to speak, for the people now know who is going to speak to them. It is the great Elioda.
Thank you, James, for that remarkable brief and making us know who the Honourable Minister is. Honourable Minister, now it is my pleasure and honour to invite you to give your remarks to this young, very innovative mind. The Vice Chancellor, Maroni University of Science and Technology, the head of the Computing and Informatics Department, Dr. Evaris Nabasa, and Dennis, who surprised me with things that I had even forgotten. Those who are representing NITA, Comtech, Patrick from the ministry, and all of you members of this summit. From Barra University, every time you have called me, there is something serious that you want to show me. So I said, okay, I will still come. But I got caught up, and I sincerely apologize for keeping you here. And that's why when I came, I said, okay, instead of going to 12 exhibitions and then keeping people here waiting, maybe some have to go to parties or have to go and revise. That's why I said, okay, let me come. We close the conference or the summit, and then I can take time to meet the exhibitors. Allow me also to appreciate Dennis. Certainly, he's taken me by surprise. This is what the people of Shalom Discord should hear. I should take you to for the campaign in 2021. So, of course, sometimes people get used to me. You think I'm a very simple man. Actually, you should also add that I was the first chairman of the Interparliamentary Union, HIV AIDS Advisory Committee. The Interparliamentary Union brings together 149 parliaments of the world. And we started that in, I think, around 2006. And I used to go to Geneva to chair meetings for about 3 years. And I remember going to Philippines, going to Bangladesh, Brazil, the United States Congress, as chairman of that Interparliamentary Union. And so since me and some other members of parliament, including a senator of the US, are the ones who initiated that committee, then parliament sat and voted me through an election, and I won. And therefore, I think you can also add it there. Can we place maybe some of those things? What the main numbers? 6 numbers. I also want to thank the Vice Chancellor for inviting me I'll be there to make sure you participate in science and technology and promoting science and technology at this university, including lobbying for funding for a grant from the World Bank to support farm biotruck to ensure that we're able to look at our medicinal plants and get out active ingredients and make sure that we can be able to provide health care using what God gave us. I also want to congratulate the Department of Informatics and Computing, led by Dr. Evarist, for organizing the very first ever Innovation Technology Summit for Africa. So now it can also be on record. The first ever minister to address the first ever Innovation Technology Summit. Yeah, see? Because, Frank who was needed to come, did he? So, now, is there another minister who has addressed? So, Elioda Tumwesigye goes down in history as the first ever cabinet minister to address the first, to address the Innovation and Technology Summit for Africa here at Uganda. They might come next year, but for sure, the first to address. You can modify the past, I mean the future, but you can't change the past. That's not happened. Allow me also to thank the organizers and the funders, people who put this together. Now, I was looking at you, what you've been able to go through since yesterday, and I want to share myself with what you discussed. Certainly, we've got through what technology and innovations, not in abstract, but solve pressing societal challenges. You should be able to see what are the challenges that people face. And then you look at innovations or new technologies that will help solve those challenges. Africa now, let me start with Uganda. Uganda, currently about 40 million people. By 2030, we shall be 63.8 million. And by 2050, we shall be 105.7 million. When you go to East Africa, we are now about 180 million. The six countries, South Sudan, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Rwanda, and Burundi. By 2050, East Africa won't be having 442 million people. Africa, we are about 1.2 billion, 1.2, 1.3 billion. By 2050, Africa, we shall be 2.5 billion. Actually, by 2050, the whole world, just like now we say, for every seven people on this planet, one is the Chinese, right now. But by 2050, because now we have monitored the population in China, even when they lifted the ban on one child policy, they now allow people to have more children. But because of education and others, people are not necessarily producing. And because of some genetics and evolution. So even despite lifting that ban, still the population of China will start falling in 7 years' time. So China is not going to necessarily grow population. But Africa, by 2050, when you have four people on this planet, one will be an African. And this is purely evolution. The biological diversity of Africans makes them survive more, despite measles, despite wars. Aha. Recently, in Hungary, the Prime Minister of Hungary even decreed that a woman who delivers should be exempted from income tax forever. Actually, you go further. By 2100, on this planet Earth, there will be very few people, but most of them will be Africans. And, well, you don't want to hear this, self-replicating robots. Because by that time, reproduction might even have changed. The ability to produce new beings will be using maybe some other types of science, which you can investigate. And this one I actually got like this projection of 2100. I even got it from a professor from UK, whom I was in South Africa. We are going to visit a 1 kilometer array. They have a radio isotope, radio telescopes, which are 1 kilometer. So we are going to visit, and they are okay with this information. So now, if you are to go and do innovations, we have to see how to strategize Uganda. Uganda in the heart of Africa, the part of Africa. How we are going to make Uganda earn something from these 2.5 million Africans. Even just, we now have a continental free trade area. You can sit here in Mbarara, produce a product that you can sell in Nigeria, sell in South Africa, without necessarily paying any tax in those places. And with our revived Uganda Airlines, we shall have even Uganda Air Cargo, we can be able to fly things to Congo, fly things to Nigeria, to where? It's you the brains to see what products to put there. So you have to do innovations that are going to help solve those challenges that will affect these millions of people. And most of you are going to be alive by 2050. Who wants to go away by 2050? Who's to be still young?
No one.
So if you stay safe down the stairs, or smart upstairs, you reach that 2050. Good one will kill you. Maybe accident. But if you don't make downstairs safe, you go. Which means all those people have to feed. So you have to, yeah, they have breakfast, have lunch, and have supper. And this won't happen at the time when the weather is changing, climate unpredictable, you can't know when to rain. So you must get away from rain to feed agriculture. You must see how to improve on production. You must use internet of things to manage farms. Yeah? So food, shelter, all those people must be housed. Yeah, in China now, they are using 3D printing to print houses. You have heard about 3D printing, I guess. These are innovators. Yeah, so people have started now printing houses using a 3D printer. Maybe they will even have 4D printer. Yeah. You know now there is even, I think, even those in theater must become 7D. In Japan, 7-dimensional cinema, right? Where you are watching, but you're also touching what you are watching in the cinema. You can go in and work with those who are shooting others in the movie. But in 7D. Yeah. Those movies, yeah, they are going to have seen. They are going to 7D. So, but in China, they are having 3D printing of houses. So shelter in the future might not necessarily be using mortar, using cement. We shall may not be using even steel for building. So as you are seeing of innovation, seeing of how you are going to be to have houses, future housing. These people have to move. You have to look at the future of mobility. Future of mobility is the big thing now in the new world. And the other time before, in December, I went to UK, and I visited their research and innovation system. And they are now, the major topic of discussion there is about the future of mobility. We are going to have a 2020 exhibition in Dubai. So recently I was talking to somebody, but he was a technology person from Russia. I traveled with him from Moscow to Dubai. So he was telling me, now what they are planning for 2020, they are going to be exhibiting, showing taxis or vehicles which fly. Because of traffic jams and what have you, you will sit in a taxi like in Kawempe. Then the taxi jumps. It puts you like a what? Crop top. Now, in the jumping, there will be no road up there. but they are using digital lanes. There will be digital roads. We are now both in the pre-industrial and also part in the fourth industrial revolution. Yeah? But we shall go there, but sorry, but sorry, if we remain stable, we shall reach. Yeah? So, future of mobility is a big issue. Even Marine University should study that. Future of mobility. How will people move, all these 2.5 million people, how will they be moving? What are the transport systems that will be at play that are in line with what are the developments? You have to look at crossing. All these 2.5 million people will have to be crossed. They would need shoes. They would need shirts and trousers. Above all, they also need undergarments. How are you planning for this? What innovations do we have in that area? Shall we all be on cotton? If so, how can we increase production of cotton? Shall we watch silk? Shall we use bananas to provide clothing? Can get the shirt from bananas, can get the shirt from pineapples. I've seen that in the Philippines. The other day, we were at the conference in Rwanda of BioInnovate, and I met some scientists from the University of Nairobi, and we are working with them. Like hides. In Uganda, when you want to turn hides into leather, the industry is so, it is so smelly, there are a lot of environmental challenges. Remember when we had a factory here in Mikokoa, of leather tanning? People almost were up in arms. So as a consequence, most we can't do that. Now we have to only produce wet brew, and then we take most, what's the wet brew, we take it to China. But even China is chasing all those industries now. But now, recently, I saw somebody who are using enzymes. So you get enzymes go to that hide and skin, they remove the skin, remove the skin, and remove the pure leather without any smell. Can you imagine that? And what do they need now? They are looking at getting biodigesters, bioreactors to do those things. So, future of clothing. Water. All these people need water. But fresh water, I hear the people every day we are struggling about river Wizi. Nobody knows whether 2050 river Wizi will be there anymore. Yeah. And of course, we have to struggle and make sure it's there. But you must have had three innovations. Somebody I think was from Kenya recently got an award for getting water in a desert from air. So you sit here and say, well, my children don't suffer. We're going to the well. Let me put the gadget here. It produces water for us. Can it produce water for irrigation from air? Just say you can get also hydrogen from water and you put it in the car and bring your hydrogen car. You have to think out good enough, you have good minds. Think of what is impossible. Make what is impossible possible. That's innovation. So, water. Hennes. I'm happy some of the exhibitions I see on Hennes, and every time I come to Comtech, they are Hennes exhibition. The future of Hennes. Now we are having a meeting of mind between nanotechnology and biotechnology to produce new products. The other day, we were talking about PT. In Israel, they were able, the last 2 weeks I think they published, they were able now for the first time to do 3D printing of a heart. The other time, on the Wednesday, I buried my uncle. His heart had swollen. Filled almost half of the chest. We buried him. And I told them that I wish this 3D printing had come, would have printed for him a heart. Yeah, but in future it's going to be possible. Because now they're able to use stem cells, they're able to use all those other nanotechnology to put in the tubes which will act as vessels. Yeah, so you get like the structure, and then that structure you put on some muscle, they even use fat, and eventually they got a computer, dictate. Then a printer prints a heart. You give me this a heart, give this one a heart. And the same I think will be done for kidneys, will be children for what? I'm telling you things just to make your mind. But they are happening. So at the end of Hades, actually somebody described what is being done in Hades as very excellent. Of course, as we do these things, there are certain challenges. Like in Hades, recently in China, somebody, you know, we have been struggling with AIDS. Even when I'm telling you to stay safe, I really want you to get what? AIDS. Those who have already got, we can't do much, we have to make sure they fight that virus. But those who are not good, yeah, you have to try very well. Although it's good, you know, people, they like sex, isn't it? Yeah, but you know, you try, but you know, they are trained. You can get something. Now, people are suffering with AIDS, what drugs, what to do. And this guy in China is very marvelous. The guy in China went and identified a gene that is causing vulnerability to HIV. So you wait, go to an embryo, go to some baby. Yeah, an embryo, and wait, and deleted that gene. And produce the baby, put in the womb, produce the baby, without a gene that is going to make this child vulnerable to HIV. But you know, the guy has been imprisoned for doing something horrible. How can you tamper with nature? God, how do you tamper with God's nature? That's what we call genetic editing. Some of you are doing the genomics. He did genetic editing. This thing is making you problematic. Yeah, I remove it. Like you get all the sick people who are sickers. So you know this person has a gene to make a child sicker. This man also has a gene. Uh-huh. When the two genes come together, he produces a sickler. So now these two people like each other. They have waited. So I use my science to say, okay, I don't want your child to suffer with pain in the bones, with transfusions. So your baby, I go in, edit this gene. And the baby is able to grow without sickle cell disease. But somebody wants to come up and say, you have interfered with what? With nature. You should allow them to do what? To deliver. So this man was arrested. Got again for A6. But as a science, also recently, I'm just still on Hades, telling you innovations. Also recently, somebody did what they call gene silencing. Gene silencing means like, usually for a human being, or anything, you have a genotype, your genetic makeup. That genotype, together with the environment, determine your phenotype, how you're going to operate. So for any disease or any whatever, it's totally an expression of your genotype. So these guys, what they do, they have now discovered the ability to go and silence that gene from expressing itself into that phenotype. So somebody, what I see in porphyria, they're able not to prevent that person from the effects. So, but I can go on and on, I don't want to bore you. There are even innovations in energy, renewable energy, and others. So the innovations you make, the thinking, and I'm sure you're good at this, I saw you in the Comtech, you find a challenge. Then now you seek a solution. And you produce a product. And we'll be happy with that. I'm happy to see you are the faculty of computing and informatics, the one leading this innovation summit. Mbarara University, now for you, I want you to see it big. What is the Navasa? There are some things which you are going to live for. This is Kabbalah University, Kabbalah Western University, Bishop Stuart University. Because you are the first science and technology university where? In the Republic of what? Of Uganda. Isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So now for you, in addition to doing what you are doing, I want you to tell a person this. One, think about high performance computing. High performance computing. I think I heard of, the European Union has a project, and you said that they had developed a computer, I think it is in Manchester University, which now has the ability process data and to work like the brain of a mouse. And it was a huge achievement. You see a mouse, I think the brain of a human being is like 1,000 times the brain of a mouse in terms of functionality. In other words, people are still far away from reaching the brain. But they are better in this step. They have been able to make computers that now can reason and work like a mouse. In Bieber. The mouse in the Bieber, what is it? One of those relatives of the Bieber. Of a rat. So what's called a mouse? Looks like it's a computer mouse. Eh? Aha. But, and when you go to like Brazil, Russia, China, South Africa, the BRIC countries, BRICS countries, they also collaborate on high performance computing. That's a new area, that's an area. We have not arrived. When you have a Big Mac or what, now, for you start thinking now beyond that. What computers should we start seeking? Of course, I know for Uganda it's as well. Even if we can assemble these computers, there's no problem. But for your university, you must do research towards high performance computing. And it should help us. I think for you already on the backbone, Murray University. Yeah, but you need a lot of other years to be on the backbone with high speed internet. Two, once you have to work on artificial intelligence. Because as you realize in the fourth industrial revolution, artificial intelligence is going to play a big role. I think I don't even know what's going to happen to this mankind in the future. Because nearly over the job. Like in some cities now, even waste, the collection of waste is being done by artificial intelligence. The vehicle comes there, picks the things on its own. Lighting, there are things which are monitoring. It's now, there are few people on the street walking, so nobody needs the light, it switches off the light. Yeah. They have gone so far that even now some of the robots, they have tried to do emotion, to make emotions in the robots. Because originally there would be no emotion, so people like can make like a house girl, a housemaid. Bring me tea! It brings you tea. Yeah? Uh-huh. Okay, switch on for me the TV. Switch it on. Go off. Uh-huh. Brush my shoes. It brushes your shoes. But now like if you are feeling bad, I'm sick. It can sympathize with you. Now, through neuroscience, people have studied neuroscience. They know what makes you sick. They know the neurotransmitters in the brain, which constitutes the brain. Now they are starting to infuse them in these robots. So they also, so you can tell, say, I've lost my uncle. The robot can even start crying for you. Yeah. That's how far robotics are going. And actually now the debate is shifting on how do we ethics of robots? If like somebody can go and design a robot which is instructed using algorithms, you know you have algorithms which you are working on to instruct a robot to do something. So you might put in algorithms and when you go to a room and you find they are just black, anybody who is black, Shoot that way. And it will come. And it takes with a brand, shoot, with maximum precision. Yeah? So now, whom would you take to court? The one who made the algorithm? The one who made the machine? Or the one who bought it? Yeah? This is one of the first world, those are debates in the first world. As for last one, debating simple things. They are debating some of those things. So the whole subject of artificial intelligence is going to be a big thing as we move ahead. So our University of Science and Technology should take the lead in doing research on artificial intelligence. The other work that is involved in is big data analytics. Big data analytics. I'm sure the guy in Nita, this is his field. Big data. Yeah. Big data systems, like all this data in the banks, data on mobiles, data on what, all this data, that's money. Who is protecting our crowd? Who is responsible for the crowd? Are all our students going abroad or they're in the country? How can Mara University, you cannot, nobody stops you from having a data center here. As a department of computer and informatics, for money, you can have a big data center here. And you earn money, but also keyboard, but also ability to use that data to make decisions, which is the big data analytics. Of course, machine learning and serverless technologies. Machine learning is almost similar to artificial intelligence. But you must also do research on technologies which do not depend on servers. Yeah, most of the work depends on the server. Now the world is thinking of how can you have technologies that you don't have to depend on the server. What can you depend on? Data engineering and architecture. You should have that course here. Data engineering and architecture. And of course, from it all, with a special, people must be trained in that concept of Internet of Things, where you're using internet to control many, many things and many appliances. For us as a ministry, we are there for you. Yeah, I think when I started coming to the Mara University, maybe I was there, I was already in the ministry. I was the only employee of the ministry for 6 months almost. The only person. But I started, you know, it's very wonderful to create. I started creating. Now we'll think, I'll see what I can say now. Now which department should I create? The morning I call public service, I think we should have this department. That's how I came in that department of this man. Wherever I would go, I would find people, may I have an innovation here. Even a guy from Uganda here came to me. He drove with a big motorcycle, huge motorcycle, found me at home, in my village. Said, you know man, I've discovered a big helicopter. I said, really, a big helicopter? Yes. He said, you see, my people in Wiz have been suffering. The women, when they want to deliver, they have to go to Mara Hospital. But sometimes getting transport here is a problem. So I said, make a helicopter that can help them, that can lift them, go above these mountains of Mizi and take them to Marada. So he made a helicopter. Now he started in it, but now he took it out. The power of propulsion is able to move that. He was able to put in power of propulsion. So it went up. But now it couldn't come down. So he had to fight with it, bring it down, and it cut him. You know, you have even had wounds. So now I said, but now if you have not come to me, how would people, how would that go? Then the other time I was also going to Karamoja. Somebody stopped to me, stopped to me. That was the time when the first lady was still in Karamoja and was Minister of Medicine. Then somebody stopped to me, so UAM stopped to me. I said, now what? I said, you know, I was looking for any minister, so when I saw CM, I said, now, I want you to one day the first lady that for me. Now, I don't see her, but they stopped to me. Now I've discovered, I was able to make a tractor, I made a vehicle for NRM, but now I've even made an arrow. The arrow, I've motorized it. So now the arrow can be more accurate and can even be able to move at high speed to hit its target. And then of course you had the story of the tear gas boy. After that one we took was the ministry, we gave him almost 400 million. Now that's why he's busy making what? Tear gas. We could research on it. But the bit why we actually gave him more money also. I had the vice chancellor talking about these rapers. This boy is able to make a chemical. Like if you're a woman or a girl, but of course even these days they rape men also, men can rape men. You know? You just have that casing. Yes? A dispenser. Once somebody starts wanting to rape you, you just like you do like for mosquito. You know? Spraying. Just spray this toxic thing. He will just run away. So that man, we supported him. But the point I'm trying to make is, there are many innovations and we can never know them. So that's why I said, okay, let me start and create the Department of Innovations and Intellectual Property Management, which he heads now. Yes. So now, we wouldn't be able to know what. So we created the departments. Now what we have done, after creating the departments, now my ministry has many people. We have almost how many? 100? about 100 now. What you have done is relevant to you. On 21st of March, we were able to pass through cabinet what we call a research and innovation framework. This research and innovation framework will now be a channel for government to put in money to support innovators. And that has been approved. So I think starting next financial year, we shall start now having that framework improved. And we are going to support basic research, we support commercialization, we will support technology development. So the man was saying, ladies were saying, I normally come with mangoes, and unfortunately the mango have come with it, it's not yet ripe, but it's very soon it will be ripe and be falling down. And I hope Barra University will be represented on the Research and Innovation Framework Steering Committee. Finally, the Vice Chancellor did tell you a few weeks ago, if not months ago, I wrote to you. Because as part of our sector development plan, we are going to look to be able to fulfill what is objective number 3 of our NDP and also signed in the 24th division. The establishing of modern state-of-art infrastructure. Under that, we are supposed to have what we call a science and technology parks. We are planning for science and technology parks, 5 of them in Uganda. We are also planning for municipal innovation and technology hubs. And as you might have heard, at SANGA we are also going to put up the science, technology, engineering center with modern equipment that you can use to make machines or to make products for your slaves. This science and technology park, we wrote him to give us about 50 acres of land. Now, we are not going to build all the 5 at a go. We don't have that money. So we wrote to you, we wrote other universities, Wustema, Guru, where? So whatever university first writes to us saying we have land, that's the one we shall start with. Yeah, because the thing is very expensive, it's over $80 million. In this area, the project park, and of course, Barra is very perfect. Because you see, you have Barra in also science and technology. The times I've come here, I've seen a lot of products, a lot of startups. Then you have also other universities in the same area, Bishop Stuart, you have KIU, you have so many around. Even the other day we watched another university in St. Joseph's. And of course, there's a big university in my municipality called Angola Western University. You know that. Yeah, it also started as a science and technology institute. So now all these mean that there is an ecosystem. There are young minds who have been trained. Now these young minds, all they want is space. They want analytical laboratories. And they want capital. And then they start businesses. And they employ people. They make money. So, Barra is a perfect place. So, by chance, I hope you are going to use the council. And I would be happy if you are the first one to give us this land amongst all universities. So they don't say that I'm taking to a place near my home, but rather they say it's the first university allocate land to the science and technology park. But all above all, it's a place that has an ecosystem. In Dubai, these guys in Dubai have a lot of money. So they went and saw the Silicon Valley in USA. They say we are going to put up a Silicon Valley lake in Dubai. They put up buildings, but it never became a Silicon Valley. Because a science and technology park of Silicon Valley is not about buildings only. It's about people that have the intelligence. A science and technology park brings together high-tech industries, not industries that produce like meat, milk, millet. No! You are talking about industries that can make like those robots. Industries that can make drugs. Yeah? And that use a lot of money. So we, in that park, we are going to put nanotechnology, biotechnology, laboratories, and all the others. So I would be happy if they are, like you know, all of you innovators, that's the place you go. So you have that ecosystem. So I want to thank you once again for inviting me. Then, for the rest of our special needs, I think we can go up on that. Especially with buildings, shopping, and also gadgets for using. And because with technology now, there's no more disability with technology. Even the other day I saw them discovering they have now been able to put electrodes in the brain. And these electrodes are able to sense what you are thinking. And they are even able to open your mouth and say what which you want to say. Technology is advancing. In Russia, they showed me a helmet. I went to university, state university. This state university was very amazing. They are even making breathproof. I mean, they are making even guns that can enter any breathproof on this planet. They showed me that. But in terms of knowledge, they showed me a helmet which you put on. Now, like you go to a conference. So they said now for translations, they give you a helmet with a translator. Now, in these helmets, they're able to put in technology which is able to know what you are thinking. So, these laws I appreciate. But let's work on technology. You are in the right place. With technology, the sky is no longer the what? The limit. Because actually, with technology, you don't find the sky. Because in the sky, there are also other planets. I thank you so much, and I wish to take this opportunity to officially cross. I don't mind. Cement model. You cross, then that you've crossed. And you can come to officially open when they're really open. So let me cross officially this first innovation technology summit. For God and my country.